So first we'll see is Rajput policy. So what is part one saying is cordial relation. So basically they are trying to tell you that his relations were good with which people. So there are three people. Firstly, he had a great alliance with the Rajputs in the building because he gave support to one Maharana of Mewar. Okay, and how we know that he gave support to Maharana of Mewar is he raised his mansab. Now what is mansab? It is a unit in the military. So he raised his mansab from 5,000 to 6,000. Then he also gave support to Jaswant Singh. First, he was against Jaswant Singh. The reason is because Jaswant Singh had taken Shah Suja's side and also he had invited Dara Shikoh. But still, he accepted Jaswant Singh and he supported him, okay? And he restored his previous mansab. Then after that, he also supported Jai Singh. Now, why did he support Jai Singh and who Jai Singh? He was there during the time of Chhatrapati Shivaji and also in the Treaty of Purandar. So he had relation with three people properly. That is your Maharana Mewar by giving Mansab, then Jaswant Singh, and also Jai Singh. Then we'll see the conflicts. Okay, so first conflict is now about Jaswant Singh he's talking. So after Jaswant Singh died in 1678, he did not have any male heir, okay? That is any surviving male. So that's why there was a problem of gaddi. Now, obviously, if you don't have any male successor, there will be a problem of the gaddi. Now, who will sit? So there was this thing called disputed succession. So what did disputed succession say? If you have any problems regarding any heir or something, the Mughal administration, that is your Khalisa, will ensure law and order in your full state and take care of your full administration. Okay. So, and soon as a problem was resolved, like you get a male successor, they would give you everything back. So that is your disputed succession. And the example is given of Jaisalmer. Then they are even telling you why there was an other reason that he bought Marwar under Khalisa. Like we know Mewar was to the right side and Marwar was to the left side. Now they are telling you about Marwar, why he bought them in under Khalisa. So he's saying that during the time of Jai Singh, he used to take many loans, okay? And that's why Aurangzeb had control over all his land. And so many of them used to fight for the gaddi ki who will take it because he took many loans from many people. So this created a lot of disturbance there. Now they are talking to you about anticipating resistance from the Rathod. Okay. Now Aurangzeb had allotted two parganas in Marwar for the maintenance of the family of the supporters of Jaswant Singh. Now we know Jaswant Singh died, okay? So now Aurangzeb, what he did, he gave two parganas. So that there would be some further maintenance of his family and he also gave support. But now comes in the picture Rani Haddi. Now who's Rani Haddi? She's the wife of Jaswant Singh. So she was very against. Obviously, if somebody comes and tries to rule in your own land, you will not like. So she was very against that Aurangzeb was trying to rule in that land. So it is written here. She was the chief queen of Jaswant Singh who had been objecting to handing over her charge of Jodhpur to the Mughals since it was her own vatan, that is her homeland of the Rathods. Okay. And what did the Mughals did? There were many Mughal officials posted there. Okay. And what did they did? They tried to find the treasures of Jaswant Singh. What was there? And it disturbed Rani Haddi a lot. Then Aurangzeb had no intention of retaining control over the territory of Marwar. So we seen first he didn't have any any approach that he would have taken the territory, or he even didn't have any intention. But after that he's seen ki this was very important, okay, strategically very important between Gujarat and Delhi because there were seaports there. Then after that we come to know after Aurangzeb after Jai Singh died, then he gets two heirs, okay, that is he gets two sons. Now we just see like a small family tree, okay? First is Maharana Pratap, okay? Maharana Pratap has two sons. One is your Amar Singh and one is your Jaswant Singh. Amar Singh ka grandson is Inder Singh and Jaswant Singh ka son is Ajit Singh. Now who is this Ajit Singh? Is they came later on, okay? First after Jaswant Singh died, there was nobody. So there was a fight then Ajit Singh came, okay? So this is like a family tree. So now we'll see. However, before reaching Delhi, Aurangzeb decided to. So, what did Aurangzeb do? He awarded Tika. Now, Tika is a throne of Jodhpur to Inder Singh, okay? The grandson of Jaswant Singh's elder brother. That's your Amar Singh. And he also gave Amar Singh in return for succession fee of 36 lakhs in rupees. Okay, so now there was a problem. First, when Shah Jahan was ruling, instead of giving Amar Singh, he gave Jaswant Singh. But when Aurangzeb started ruling, he was thinking that what mistake did he do, Shah Jahan? So he gives to Amar Singh's grandson, Inder Singh. Now, there is one Rajasthani work called Hukumat-e-Ri-Bahi. So what it was written in that, it was written ki Aurangzeb offered a mansab to Ajit Singh and also gave two parganas. Which two parganas he gave? Sojat and Jaitaran. Okay. Then Aurangzeb also wanted to, he gave pargana, so he also had an idea to a partition of Marwar to do it. Then we see who comes in the picture is the Rathore Sardars led by Durgadas. So there was this Rathore Sardars and the main head was Durgadas. So angered at the rejection of, he didn't accept what Aurangzeb said, okay? And then what Aurangzeb also did, he ordered that the prince and their mothers will be put in confinement at the fort of Navgarh. So he didn't even like this thing. This alarmed the Rathore Sardars, who after valiant fight made their escape from Agra along with one of the princes and crowned him. So obviously the Rathore Sardars were led by Durgadas and they were against whatever Aurangzeb did. So what he did, he crowned Ajit Singh, okay? And Aurangzeb never wanted Ajit Singh. Aurangzeb wanted Inder Singh. Aurangzeb might have gracefully accepted the fact that, and mostly the Rajput people always gave preference to Ajit Singh and not Inder Singh. But as we know, Aurangzeb always wanted him. And he came to know that Inder Singh had no following among the Rathors. Then after that, we see that Aurangzeb crushed the Rathors. And that Durgadas also fled with Ajit Singh to Mewar. And the Rana also sent them to hide. You'll see the Rana later. It was at this stage that Mewar entered on the war of the side of Ajit Singh. Then we see Rana Raj Singh. Now, who's this Rana Raj Singh? He was once a friend of Aurangzeb, but then he alienated from him. Okay. Then he had sent 5,000 men under one of his leading men to Jodhpur to back up the claim of Rani Hati. Apparently, he was deeply opposed. So, what is Rana Raj Singh? He was first Aurangzeb's friend, then he left him. And he was very upset ki obviously why are the Mughals interfering in the internal affairs of the Rajput and especially in the question of the succession ki who will sit in it. Apart from this then he also detached the Marwar state, okay, when he tried to partition it. To its south and west, Dungarapur, Banswara, etc., which at one time was tribute paying or dependent ruler, that state he tried to divided, okay, detached it from Mewar. Then after that, in Aurangzeb in November 1679, he started attacking Mewar. And what he did, he started raiding the camp of Rana. Okay, as we seen above, that is that Rana Raj Singh. He went, but what happened is this Rana Raj Singh was hiding into the hills and it became very difficult for the Mughals to fight guerrilla warfare. Then at last comes your eldest son of Aurangzeb, that's your Prince Akbar, okay? He's seen the situation of his father and he was also against it. So what he did, he joined his hands with Durgadas. Durgadas was who the Rathore ka chief. But obviously the father was smarter than the son. So then Prince Akbar had to flee to Maharashtra and Aurangzeb had heavy the sigh of relief, okay? Then in the camp of Mewar now became secondary for Aurangzeb. So now what Aurangzeb did, he made his bond very strong with Rana Jagat Singh. Now, Rana Jagat Singh, he is a successor of Rana Raj Singh. And what he told the Rana, he was forced to surrender all his parganas in lieu of jizya and he granted him also mansab of 5,000. And he told him, ki, you have to promise me loyalty and of not supporting Ajit Singh. As I told you all before, he never wanted only Ajit Singh on the throne, he always wanted Inder Singh. So at last he said this agreement and promise regarding Ajit Singh satisfied none of the Rajput. So nobody was happy of this decision. Then especially the Rajput rulers. Then the Mughal kept their control on Marwar and resultry warfare continued in 1698 when at last. So what did this Aurangzeb said? Ki when Ajit Singh becomes a major, that is 18 plus, he would have given him everything and he would have like you know given him everything. But the Mughals refused to relax their hold on the capital of Jodhpur. Then the Rana of Mewar too remained dissatisfied at surrender of his Pargana to the Mughal, and there was no change till Aurangzeb died in 1707. So whatever he promised, he never did it. Okay. Then we'll see the consequences of Aurangzeb. So what are the consequences? So it lies that was both Ajit Singh and also and Jai Singh also was not happy about it. Then we'll see the consequences of it. Firstly, the Rajput policy, as you know, was very clumsy and blundering. Then it also damaged the Mughal military prestige. Then not all the Rajputs, but we know ki many still supported the Mughals. Like there are example of Hadda and Kachwa. Then we also seen ki it did not show determination to subvert Hinduism as Maratha allowed in large number. Then we also see ki Aurangzeb Rajput policy was a failure. How much he tried to do, but then he didn't succeed. And then Rajput also became his enemies, okay? Then there was no support against Deccan. They thought if they would have support of the Rajput, then he would also fight in Deccan, but then there was no support. Then there was a lot of confusion and disorder also existing that time. Then Aurangzeb also, he suffered from many financial and military loss. Obviously, he had lesser money because he was every time fighting wars against Rajput. He fought so much, but then still he could not achieve any success against the Rajput. Aurangzeb was so busy in fighting wars that he left his administration like that only. So that was another problem. So also the NVC, the whole work of Akbar started by him to create the natural spirit was destroyed. The equality had begun to grow between two community came almost to an end or was on its way to disappear. As we know, ki, there was many fights after that. Then we'll see religious policy. One second. So now we'll see Akbar's religious policy, okay? We'll see Akbar first. So they are trying to tell you ki about Akbar's religious policy between 1560 and 65, okay? So they are trying to tell you ki Akbar was very nice and he tried to establish his matrimonial relations with the Rajput. He was very good to the Rajput. He tried to even abolish the pilgrim tax. He even prohibited the conversion of prisoners of war to Islam. He abolished jizya. So now by looking at all this, we obviously come to know ki Akbar was a secular emperor, okay? Now he had his works known as Gulzar-e-Abrar and Nafis-ul-Masiri. What it suggests that Akbar showed deep respect to the ulemas and bestowed upon them this group abundant favor. So we know the ulemas were the Muslim scholar religious, okay? Religious, Muslim religious who were scholar and he favored them a lot. Now they are telling you why was Akbar liberal, okay? Now they are trying to tell you he was liberal because he was brought up and his upbringing in that surrounding was like that. So that's why he was liberal and he was also molded by his own personal beliefs. He had also forsaken Islam and he had a tolerant attitude. As we seen before, he was very secular. So he took decisions very nicely. Then we also seen ki he had very little alternative to seek alliance with the Rajput and Indian Muslims, okay? And also he had given concessions to non-Muslim because he always wanted the support of the non-Muslims as well as the Muslims. So he didn't do any partiality with them. Now they are telling you, first they told you ki how he was good and then they told you why he was liberal and now they are telling you about his criticisms, okay? So, Anna, how do you know that about his criticism? So, it's written in a document signed by his wakil, that is Munim Khan. So, what all he says, ki Akbar had issued a famous Fatnama of Chittor. Then he also speaks about Akbar started a collection of jizya in the vicinity of Agra. Then he also declared war against the Rajput at Jihad. And he also started destroying temples and killing the Kafirs. Okay, so he did all these things. Then we also see in Sharaf-e-Usmani, which tells that the emperor ordered, now he ordered some Qazi Abdul Samad of Bilgram. Why he ordered him? So that he could check if anybody was doing idol worship. Now there's an other historian that is Badawi who said he Akbar re-imposed jizya though it did not work. So he even did that. Then there's a point saying that at an atmosphere of religious intolerance, most of the Rajput chieftains joined his service during the years of 1566 to 79. So he's saying whatever he did, whether he tried to import, he re-import jizya, or he had appointed people to see who were doing idol worship, destroying of temples also. But still many Rajput chieftains joined his services. So according to Akbar, religion was not the main concern of the Mughal Empire. But he used it as a political rule, okay? Then we also talk about Ibadat Khana. So firstly, what was Ibadat Khana? It was to have free discussions on various aspects of Islam theology. So they used to be in one room and discuss about Islam. Then after that, he seen that people were quarreling among themselves, Then what he did is, he opened this discussion to many other people. This Ibadat Khana was open to the Sufis, the Shias, the Brahmins, the Jains, the Krishnas, Jews, and the Parsis, okay? So, according to this, what convinced Akbar ki this was all based on religion. When he brought all the people together, it was, based on reason, okay? Then he already proved himself as Imam Adil also. He used to interpret all the questions, like all the legal questions and all that. And even if there was a difference in any opinion of the ulemas also, he used to take care of it, okay? Whatever he said was important that time. So he proved himself as, or called himself as, Imam A. Adil. Then we see the Tawhid E. Ilahi. Okay, this was mistaken as Dini Ilahi. Now this was like not a religion. How we call it not a religion? Because there was no sacred books, there were no scriptures, there was no priestly hierarchy, there was no sacred place of worship. So we come to know that this was not a religion. So what he basically tried to say is that if you wanted to follow this, you could follow this. And you had, what you had to do is, you had to take sacrifice of property, life, honor, religion. And this was not related to religion at all. Okay. And what he said at last, it was entirely a personal matter, not between the emperor and the subjects, but between Akbar and those who chose to regard him as their own guru. If you wanted, you could join him. If you wanted to believe like he is your teacher also, you could join this thing. That is a Tawhid Ilahi. So basically, he wanted to become a spiritual guide. Okay. Now in the conclusion, they are saying ki Akbar, in the interest of political consolidation, did not generally resort to religious discrimination. Okay. He didn't do any religious discrimination. But he seen ki if anybody threatened his position and all, then he used to punish them. Okay. And we already seen ki he used to not take any stern actions against a religious group, but against any individual person. Then now we'll see Jahangir. Now, R.P. Tripathi says that Jahangir was more orthodox than his father and less than his son Khurram. So we seen ki he says ki he's more orthodox than Akbar and less than his father, that is Shahjahan. Okay. Now, what is it? He took very harsh steps. He took harsh steps against the Sikhs, the Jain, and the Sunni. And also, he was against many individuals. Okay, that is Guru Arjan Singh, there are example, Man Singh Suri, Sheikh Ahmad Sirindi, etc. Okay. Then after that, we find that he also had visited Jadru Gosain 3 times and discussed with him about Hindu philosophy. This is just a fact. Then we find that Jahangir sometimes got provoked by sectarian opinions of other persons. There are other sectarian opinions. Some people hate some religion. So he got provoked by them. And what he did do, there is an example. The Sheikh had claimed that once in his dream, so he imprisoned the Sunni religious leader, that is Sheikh Ahmad Sirindi. Now what did Sheikh Ahmad Sirindi claim? That once in his dream, he came closer to God than the Caliph in his past. So because of that, he was against to whatever he said and he imprisoned him. Then many other Muslims, namely Kapuk, Abdul Latif and all also was imprisoned. And whoever's opinion he never liked, he imprisoned them. So it is noteworthy that the percentage of Hindu Mansabdar did not decrease during Jahangir's reign. So whatever he did also, there was no decrease of any Hindu Mansabdar in his period. And he never launched any policy which would have disrupted the Hindu place of worship. Like he never said that there would be any destruction of temple. And he also did not reimpose jizya. And he never also forced people to convert into Islam. So that's it.